in almost any introductory course in abstract algebra. The group is the very first mathematical object of study. And this is for good reason. Groups are absolutely fundamental to mathematics and to nature. They have a simple definition, yet they give rise to a theory which is incredibly rich and complex. They're a perfect example of how mathematical objects can carry hidden structure, and how abstraction can help us clarify ideas. In this video, I hope to convince you of all of this. Assuming no background in group theory, we aim to accomplish the following three goals. First, we'll define what a group is. Then, we'll prove a result known as Cayley's theorem, which we'll use to motivate why we study groups. Finally, we'll prove a structural result central to all of group theory, known as Lagrange's theorem. First, we give a brief overview of the necessary set theory. Recall that a set is a collection of objects, and that a function from a set X to a set Y is just a way to associate to each element of X an element of Y. We say that such a function is injective if no two elements of X map to the same element of Y, and we say that it's surjective if every element of Y is mapped to. If a function is both injective and surjective, we say that it's bijective, and we call it a bijection. Given a bijection f from x to y, flipping all of the arrows in the diagram gives us a bijection from y to x called the inverse of f. Finally, the composition of two functions is just the result of applying one, then the other, from right to left. With this, we're ready to define permutation groups. Let x be a set, and let sim x denote the set of bijections from x to itself. A permutation group on x is a non-empty subset P of sim x, which is closed under composition and inversion. That is, for all functions f and g in P, the composition of f and g and the inverse of f are both in P. Here's an example. If x is a set with two elements, then sim x consists of the identity map on x, which we'll call f, and the bijection which swaps the two elements of x, which we'll call g. This is a permutation group, and group theorists like to call it S2. The S is short for symmetric group, and the 2 refers to the fact that X has two elements. Given any two bijections in S2, we can compose them to get another bijection. This structure, where any two elements in the permutation group can be composed to get another element of the permutation group, can be captured in a multiplication table. If X instead has three elements, then sim X consists of these six bijections. And here's the multiplication table. Recall that function composition is performed right to left, meaning, for example, the function boxed in yellow is the result of applying the function boxed in red, then the function boxed in orange. In the two examples we've seen so far, our permutation group consisted of all bijections from X to itself, but it's also possible for a permutation group to contain only some of these bijections. For example, looking at our multiplication table for S3, we notice that just these first three bijections, which cycle the three elements of X, are closed under composition and inversion, and so they form a permutation group of size 3. The standard name for this permutation group is the cyclic group of order 3, or C3 for short. Since C3 is a subset of S3, which is itself a permutation group, we call it a subgroup of S3. Permutation groups are a concrete example of a more abstract mathematical object known as a group. The idea is that we don't want to pay attention to how exactly each bijection shuffles the elements of X. Instead, all we care about is what happens when we compose them. To this end, we give the following definition. A group is a set G equipped with a binary operation, which we'll call composition for now, satisfying the following properties. First, composition must be associative. Second, there must be an identity element, which we define to be an element for which composing with it does nothing. Third, every element little g in G must have an inverse, which we define to be an element which, when composed with little g, becomes the identity. Let's check that permutation groups are actually groups. Recall that a permutation group is a non-empty set of bijections from a set to itself, closed under composition and inversion. Being closed under composition ensures that composition is a binary operation. Associativity follows from the fact that function composition is associative. Existence of inverses follows from the fact that permutation groups are closed under inversion. All that's left to show is that permutation groups have an identity element. To see this, we let P be an arbitrary permutation group, and notice that since P is non-empty, we may fix an element G in P. Since P is closed under inversion, the inverse of G is in P, and since P is closed under composition, G of G inverse is in P, but this is equal to the identity, and we're done. In order to abstract away from viewing group elements as concrete permutations of a set, it's convention in group theory to call composition multiplication instead, and to omit the corresponding symbol. And since we're now calling it multiplication, we might as well write 1 to denote the identity instead of ID. This notation is more or less standard. As we just saw, every permutation group is a group. It may be surprising that the converse is true as well. That is, every group arises from some permutation group. This fact is known as Cayley's theorem, and proving it will be our first major goal in this video. To understand what we mean by arises from, consider the following example. Let G be the group consisting of the elements 1 and negative 1, with group multiplication just being ordinary multiplication. Compare this to S2, the permutation group we saw earlier consisting of the identity and a bijection which swaps two elements. Looking at their multiplication tables, it's clear that they're just relabelings of one another. Even though the groups were defined in different ways, and the elements have different names, they're essentially the same in terms of structure. More concretely, there's a way to match up the elements on the left with the elements on the right via a bijection phi, such that multiplication on the left and right agree with one another. For example, on the left, -1 times -1 is 1, and on the right, phi of -1 times phi of -1 is phi of 1. In this case, we say that our two groups are isomorphic, and we call phi an isomorphism. Let's state this in mathematical language. Given two groups G and K, a map phi from G to K is called a group isomorphism if it's bijective and satisfies phi of G times phi of H equals phi of GH for all G and H in G. If we remove the condition that phi is a bijection, then we call phi a group homomorphism. So what Cayley's theorem is really saying is that given any group G, that is, a set equipped with associative multiplication with identity and inverses, there exists a permutation group, that is, a collection of bijections from a set to itself closed under composition and inversion, which is isomorphic to G. The first step to proving this theorem is to prove a general fact about group homomorphisms. Let phi be a group homomorphism from a group G to a group K. Our claim is that the image of phi is a subgroup of K. To prove this, we check the group axioms. First, we must show that imphi is closed under multiplication, meaning the product of any two things in imphi is still an imphi. To see this, we simply realize that since phi is a group homomorphism, by definition we have that phi of G times phi of H equals phi of GH, which is in the image. Second, we must show that multiplication in imphi is associative. This is true because imphi lies in K, and multiplication in K is associative since K is a group. Third, we must show that imphi has an identity element. That is, there is some element phi of H for which multiplying by it does nothing. To see this, we set H equal to the identity element in G, which we'll call 1G. Then, by applying the defining property of group homomorphisms, we see that phi of 1G does indeed do nothing when you multiply by it. Finally, we must show that imphi is closed under inversion. That is, for each element phi of G, there exists some element phi of H such that multiplying the two yields the identity. To see this, we set H equal to the inverse of G. This causes their product to equal phi of 1G, which, as we just saw in the previous step, is the identity in imphi. With this, we can now begin our proof of Cayley's theorem. Let G be a group. Our goal is to show that G is isomorphic to a permutation group. We'll do this by constructing an isomorphism from G to a permutation group on the set G. Let phi be the function from G to sim G, given by sending each element H in G to the left multiplication map by H. That is, for any element H in G, we define phi of H to be the bijection from G to itself, which sends each element to H times that element. To see that phi of H really is a bijection, we need only observe that it has an inverse, namely the left multiplication map by H inverse. Phi is a group homomorphism because performing a left multiplication by H1 to the result of left multiplying by H2 is the same as left multiplying by H1H2. By our previous lemma, we have that imphi is a subgroup of simg, and therefore a permutation group. From now on, we will view phi as mapping into imphi. So we now have that phi is a group homomorphism from G to the permutation group imphi. It's surjective by definition of image, and we observe that phi is also injective since every left multiplication map takes the identity to somewhere different. This means that phi is an isomorphism from the group G to the permutation group imphi, and the proof is complete. Since we now know that all groups are permutation groups, it would be reasonable to say that group theory is the study of bijections from a set to itself. A common way to express this idea is to say that group theory is the study of symmetry. For example, the symmetries of a square consisting of flips and rotations that take the square to itself form a group called D8. Each of these symmetries is a bijection from R2 to itself. We're not limited to symmetries of geometric shapes. In mathematics, the objects we're interested in often look like sets equipped with some additional structure. A group is one such example, and there are many others. An isomorphism from such an object to itself is called an automorphism. The group of all automorphisms of an object can tell us a lot about the object itself, and this is a major reason why groups are so important in mathematics. Our remaining goal in this video is to prove one of the most fundamental theorems in finite group theory, Lagrange's theorem. First, recall that the cardinality of a set is simply the number of elements the set contains. If this set happens to be a group, then another name for its cardinality is the order of the group. Lagrange's theorem states that given any finite group G and any subgroup H, the order of H divides the order of G. Let's take a moment to examine what this is saying. For example, Lagrange's theorem tells us that if G is a group of order 100, then it's impossible for G to have a subgroup of order 3, since 3 does not divide 100. Just looking at the group axioms, it's not so obvious why this should be impossible. In this way, Lagrange's theorem gives us a huge amount of information about the possible structures that a group can have. To prove Lagrange's theorem, we first give the following definition. Let G be a group, and let H be a subgroup. Given an element little g in G, we write little gh to denote the set of all elements of the form little g little h for some little h in H. We call little gh a left coset of H in G. Left cosets have a couple of key properties that we'll now work to understand. First, every element of G is contained in some left coset of H. To see this, we realize that each element little g in G is contained in the left coset little gh, since little g equals little g times 1, and 1 is an H since H is a subgroup. Second, any two distinct left cosets of H are disjoint, that is, they don't overlap. To see this, let G1 and G2 be elements of G, and suppose that the cosets G1H and G2H are not disjoint. That is, there exists some element G0 in their intersection. Our goal is to prove that this implies G1H and G2H are equal. Since G0 is in G1H, there exists some H1 in H, such that G0 equals G1H1. Substituting this into the expression G0H, we find that G0H equals G1H1H, which just equals G1H, since H is closed under multiplication. The exact same argument applied to G2 tells us that G0H equals G2H, and therefore G1H equals G0H equals G2H, as desired. Finally, all left cosets of H have cardinality equal to that of H. To see this, we realize that given a left coset little gh, the left multiplication map by little g is a bijection from H to little gh, since its inverse is the left multiplication map by little g inverse. These three properties of left cosets tell us that given a group G and a subgroup H, the left cosets of H split G into disjoint subsets, all with cardinality equal to that of H. Letting n denote the number of these disjoint subsets, we have that the cardinality of G equals n times the cardinality of H, meaning the cardinality of H divides the cardinality of G, completing our proof of Lagrange's theorem. Group theory is one of my favorite areas of mathematics because groups arise from a very simple and natural phenomenon, which I hope Cayley's theorem has convinced you of. And yet, groups carry a huge amount of hidden structure, which I hope Lagrange's theorem has convinced you of. The topics covered in this video are only the beginning. I've listed on screen some of what I think are the most awe-inspiring theorems in group theory, with words that we haven't defined highlighted in yellow. I encourage you to read more about them. A formal write-up of all the results proven in this video is linked in the video description. If you enjoyed this video, remember to like and subscribe. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.